This is the shortest film I have, therefore we are projecting this for you. It will show you how we do interdisciplinary learning, where everything is a resource to learn, and every time children are learning, connecting here sports and mathematics and language. So we'll just have a quick look at the film, and then I'll start my presentation.
Dans cette école, nous prenons beaucoup sur l'expérimentation. C'est plus sympa et c'est plus naturel qu'ils soient les acteurs. La pédagogie que je suis en train de suivre, ou bien la méthodologie que je suis en train d'appliquer, si vous voyez, ça va de l'expérientiel à la découverte. Et à partir de la découverte, on connaît. Il y a une chaîne. Ils découvrent, ils expérimentent, après ils comprennent, après ils transmettent. Faire un lien entre les maths et le sport, donc il suffit tout simplement que les élèves eux-mêmes puissent générer des données, par exemple les données des passes, les données des buts marqués et les balles interceptées. Une fois collectées les données, une fois en classe, donc on couvre différents concepts dans les mathématiques et même dans la langue, parce que vous les voyez représenter ces données, les interpréter. Et quand on interprète quelque chose, c'est la langue. Même si on est dans les mathématiques, c'est la langue. En fonction de cela, il y aura une réflexion, parce qu'ils vont se demander qu'est-ce que je vais faire pour améliorer ma performance. Ça tourne autour d'une question: qui suis-je dans mon équipe? Le plus important, ce n'est pas le fait que l'élève est bon ou bien moins bon. Même s'il n'est pas bon, dans le sport, en matière de performance, il ne peut pas échouer. Si on parle de pourcentage, il y a une contribution de chaque élève dans le match, par exemple. Même le moins bon qui a contribué 1%, cette personne-là, il doit être valorisé. Parce que sans lui, les 100% ne seraient pas complets.
So, Bernard, our professor from Senegal, who's actually a musician, chartered accountant by profession and training, and passionate about music, speaks this very important, gives this very important message about how that 1% in that 99% is important to make it the 100%. And that inclusion is an important part of education. So when we're talking about education, the first question is, of course, why go to school at all? What's the purpose? And to me, it's really a space where you can get in touch with yourself. So to know yourself, to know your strengths and weaknesses, to know your passions and desires, is an important part of education. The question, who am I, is an existential quest since millennia. And it has plagued people across civilizations, across ages. And if you don't ask that question when you're young, then at the time you're 40, you'll be having this existential midlife crisis. So this is one important part, which is a space to get to know yourself. This question is also important for children. In the memory of my daughter Tara, who left us in the year 2014, which turned our entire world as parents, Pascal and my husband is French, and Tara's departure shifted our whole world, pushed us into a different dimension altogether. And we began to find her messages after her departure. She had a sudden infection and which caused her to leave her physical body. And we began to find her messages throughout, and we continue to find them. And one of the messages that I keep here, or I keep through my conferences, is, of course, who am I? So this existential quest is not just for adults, it's for children too. But luckily, Tara was a happy child, and all her messages are about how happy she was, about love and gratitude, because she had a very strong premonition and precognition about leaving, which we didn't understand that time. Unfortunately, not many parents have that privilege. Life doesn't give that compensation, because in India, for example, every 90 minutes, there's a child who commits suicide, an adolescent, and partly due to academic pressure, one of the main reasons. The Lancet Commission report from UK states that mental health will be the largest problem amongst the young people across the world. So we need to address that in education. Of course, we need to know where are we coming from. And we're coming from the prison model, the factory of the prison model. And Foucault, Michel Foucault, who's a French philosopher, compares prisons and schools. So what is, you've got uniforms coming from prisons, the roll call, the morning assembly, the monitor system, and the supervisory model, and the subjugation of the body in order to control the mind. Finger on your lips, don't ask questions. So this supervisory model is again a colonial inheritance across the world, and it's time probably, like Sir was saying, we ask ourselves a question, do we really need to put our children in a prison model school, or do we perhaps need to change according to the new context? So when we started the school 20 years ago in Ahmedabad, coming from our own experiences, as Vidya also put it, I hated my schooling. Pascal from France, he also hated his schooling. So happiness and well-being through learning was an important objective, and of course, learner autonomy. Many great practitioners, philosophers, and mystics have inspired us. Our educational model is kind of a jugaad between different practices, but all following the humanistic model, the humanist model in education. So when we started the school, one of the founding philosophies was about diversity and inclusion, because it's a kind of an apartheid in education where you have poor going to poor schools, middle-class children going to middle-class schools, and the rich going to richer schools where they're residential schools, etc. And this mixity is actually depriving our population of the heterogeneity of the multiplicity of points of view. So this was an important part, to have children coming from even the slum areas and giving them a free education, a quality education. Of course, when we started off, one of the major problems was, well, we created a project with the Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation. So this is not a private school. It is a PPP model. It's a trust which is run under the municipal corporation. They gave a school building for the purpose. There's differential fees, that was the idea. Those who can afford can pay, those who can't afford fully will pay partly, and those who can't afford at all will pay nothing, will get free education. But they started a riot-like situation. There was bus burning, riots, blood signature campaigns, civil disobedience movement, jail bharo andolan against us. People who were ex-vice chancellors of universities said, you can't mix the rich and the poor. You cannot mix the castes and classes like that. You will create a greater inferiority complex if you do that. So there were different agendas, and there was a public interest litigation. Pascal and I were lynched by mobs several times, and of course they lost the PIL in the High Court, it went to Supreme Court, and they lost there as well, and that's when we were able to come. So, you know, when you're talking about educational models, we have to be ready for all kinds of reactions. And here, of course, we have, you can see the police posted there, Rapid Action Force, police, etc. So we went on to create a school 20 years back, and the pedagogy, we call it generated resources learning, because for us, everything is a resource to learn, and we generate our own resources, and the data, like you saw in the short film, is again generated by children. There are no textbooks. The experiential real-life projects are what children engage in, so in real time, with real people, in real human context, and we map the projects, and these projects, children vote for them. These are not imposed on the children. It's again a co-constructivist approach and framework. So what are the kind of projects we do, and how do we use, what do we mean by generated resources? Well, here, for example, children have bought, they've looked at what are they eating throughout the week and how much of packaging is being used. And you can see that they've brought all this stuff into the school. They're weighing it, they're classifying it, they're measuring it. And from there, they begin to look at what are they consuming on the packets, so the, you know, the ingredients that go into their bodies, etc. Then also looking at what is local and what is global, what is imported, looking at what are needs and wants, differentiating according to that. And then they become aware of how much of packaging is used just for one small thing that we're eating. And from there, they go on to create awareness campaigns. They go on to work with rag pickers, Seva, which is a very big organization in the city. Then also starts a new project about designing eco-friendly containers with the waste that they've collected, distributing those materials, the bags that they make into the city. And then again going on to the new kind of waste awareness about electronic waste. So new project begins. So this is a kind of a mapping you can see, you know, creating a waste solution. So the project is also determined by the problems that we are facing in society. And then we create a project around that. So it's not just finding, it's actually asking the questions, but to find solutions to them. So finding the problem is the main thing. Cafe project, we do an interdisciplinary cafe project across the years. So maths and language and science, et cetera, the children run the cafe for a few hours during, let's say in 2 months. But in doing that, they learn to do a lot of things, including, of course, the life skills. We have filmmaking projects, so it's, again, media is something very important, and the children are making films on social issues that they find important. And in the filmmaking, again, we are mapping and we are touching different subject areas like scripting, that's language, physics and lighting, sound, editing, technology, etc. One of the films, and so they're bidding. They're actually going to organizations and they make bids. So here we made films for the Election Commission of India, and the posters and films that they made, it had an outreach of 75 lakh voters across Gujarat who got the posters, and 71 lakh people signed the voter's pledge, returned it to the government of Gujarat in the voter awareness campaign. And of course, that gave a prize from civil society, as a civil society member, to the school children who did it. Just 25 children were able to have a huge impact, and the voting population that year, the percentage was much higher as compared to other school years. So the thing is also that the school is based on democratic principles, so the children make the rules themselves and they follow the rules themselves. The conflict resolution takes place through their own council meetings. Even the seating arrangement is important. I did show you the photograph earlier of the linear seating arrangement, which comes from the prison models, because the need to supervise is so strong. The teacher or the prisoner can see, supervisor can see the prisoners or the children. So here we had to think about how do we want our children to sit, and we are a municipal school building, okay? So this is a very small space. So we designed tables which go back up to the walls, and that way there are groups, no fixed seating, children move around and they work in subgroups as the project demands. And we also, it's important for the tables to go up because we use the floor as a resource. We don't have big grounds like a lot of schools do. So the floor is then, for example, painted. It becomes a giant board where they're, you know, they made a whole world map there, and you can see they can move. Then it becomes a giant board and they play games on it. The body is also a resource. So the floor is a resource. The body is a resource. So you can see children who become needles in a clock. You can see children who are doing the atom dance, so the electrons in an atom. So every time we are reducing the gap between the subject and the object of learning, going to more towards a kind of a non-duality where they are using all their senses for the learning. Of course, when you're talking about learning as being fun, and I keep saying the F word in education, most schools are using fear as a motivator, but we can also use fun and bring back the joy of learning, because human beings love learning. And so we don't use the word examination, we prefer the word evaluation, because it comes from the French word called evaluate, to give value to. And here the children are assessed on what they know, what they are good at, but also using the criterion referenced assessment and not the normative assessment models. So here you can see the evaluation report cards. They run into 30, 40 pages, but children first speak about what they have learned. So there's self-evaluation, peer evaluation, parental feedback, teacher synthesis, and of course the projects within which they did certain tasks. For example, if they do a heritage walk, they're doing tourism in the city, then they're also making the little brochure, and that's also a task that can be assessed for language and technology. Children have gone across, even though in alternative schooling, they've gone across to the top universities of the world, whether in India or abroad. So we've had a lot of case studies, underprivileged children who have gone ahead. Chandrika, who came from a municipal school, joined the school, finished her graduation, and went abroad, came back, and now is a teacher in the school. Children who have different abilities. Johan, who had dyslexia, but then through his music, we mapped his project according to his interests, and he learned physics and language, poetry, everything through his music, and was able to graduate, and he's a musician. So now, of course, our teacher training models are expanding across the world. So everything was going well, and like I said, in 2014, we lost Tara, and then we began to find the profundity of her poems and her little short sayings, which were published in many places, including the Aurobindo Ashram published it, and British Council, etc. One of the things she talks about, interconnectedness, and how we as human beings live in separation. This put us on a quest to find answers, and thereafter we went on to create what we now call the consciousness curriculum, and so that's developing intuition and the imagination, because ultimately, intuition is something that is so important for human lives. It's so important even in the teaching profession, because only a teacher will know when to push a child further or not to push a child. But this is something which is really neglected. And of course, we are also basing our work on new discoveries, like from in quantum physics, epigenetics with Rupert Sheldrake or Amit Goswami, Bruce Lipton, just to name a few, Gary Zukav. We're bringing this to the classroom. What are the kind of things we're doing? We're doing things like psychometry, taking an object or a photograph and reading it. I can tell my teachers and my students that developing the powers of the human mind to be able to read or look through a box which has an object inside it, and the box is closed. So we are projecting that, we're expanding in different ways. So here the teachers are doing that, what is known as remote viewing. Of course, our conferences now from this model has now gone to France, Switzerland, Russia. There are many alternative schools coming up in France, for example, by next year in Paris and south of France, in Geneva too, which are going to be using this pedagogy. Russia has shown a great interest. The Ministry of Education in France has shown a great interest. So these are the workshops being done for the ministry in north of France. So you can see that this model is expanding. In the end, what I'd like to say is again end with a quote from Tara when she says, "The world is a big place and I'm small, but I matter because I am matter." And ladies and gentlemen, every child matters. An education system that can push children to committing suicide is not an education system that we can have. That's all. There is no other question about it. There's no other debate about it. Can you think? And I have met them. I met this family in Ahmedabad when I was in a roundtable discussion. They'd lost their girl to, she hung herself because she thought she will not get the 85 or 90% to become a doctor. 6 months later, her mother did the same out of grief. Can you understand? Can we accept this as collateral damage? No, I cannot. I can stand here today, though I'm a parent who lost my daughter, because this child was way above everything else, because she was happy. And that's a gift she gave to us. But many parents don't have that possibility. So I don't want any more parents to go through that grief of knowing that the child left for such a terrible, such a flimsy thing. So we must create an education system that is inclusive, where every child can develop his or her full human potential, so that we can answer the question, who am I and why am I here? Thank you.